welcome to the Public Housing Section 18 Demolition and Disposition webinar. My name is Emily Coffey, and I am a Housing Justice Staff Attorney at the Shriver Center on Poverty Law. This webinar is being recorded in June of 2020, and it is critical that you look, if you're reviewing this in the future, that you look for up-to-date guidance and statutes that very well may change in the future. Also, this resource is really geared at legal aid attorneys and advocates and organizers. And if you are a public housing resident who has questions about demolition or disposition of your homes or in your community, I would really encourage you to seek legal advice for additional support with the preservation of your community and the protection of your rights. So first, I just want to discuss the terminology that I'm going to be using throughout this webinar. When I say Section 18, what I mean is Section 18 of the U.S. Housing Act of 1937. It has been amended a number of times over the years, and it is codified at 42 U.S.C. Section 1437P and implemented at 24 CFR Part 970 and PIH Notice 2018-04. I'm not going to be reading the statute throughout this presentation, but it is really important that you are looking at the statute and the implementing regulations for guidance if you are investigating a potential demolition or disposition in your community. I will say too that Section 18 is specific for the demolition or disposition of public housing. It does not apply to other forms of federally assisted housing. So we are just talking about the loss, conversion, preservation options for public housing. When I say demolition, here's the definition. It means to raze in whole or in part one or more permanent buildings of a public housing development. So we are talking about the actual demolition of the development when I say demolition. When I say disposition, I'm talking about the transfer or sale of any interest in real estate of a public housing development. So that is essentially a sale of the land or of the building that the public housing is on. It's important, I think, to ground work in Section 18, demolition and disposition. It's important to ground it on the history of the act. So in 1998, the Quality Housing and Work Responsibility Act amended Section 18 in full. It was a gut and replace that most significantly, it did a lot of things, but most significantly what it did was it removed the one-for-one replacement requirement that had previously existed for public housing that was being lost, whether through demolition or disposition. Since 1998, there's largely not been a one-for-one replacement requirement in the Section 18 program. And that has led to a significant decline in the number of public housing units that we have across the country. Also, there was a notice that HUD put out that was HUD Notice 2012-7 that included a significant number of tenant protections. And so I think it's important to look back at that notice and look at the differences between that notice and the current notice, which is 2018-04, and compare the two. One thing significantly that changed in the 2018 notice is that it dramatically expanded the rationale that can be used by public housing authorities for an approved demolition or disposition application. I also just want to give some overarching exceptions to Section 18. So there can potentially be demolition or disposition of public housing units if they meet certain qualifications without going through the Section 18 process. I'm not going to go into detail on this, but one example is the de minimis exception. So, potentially there's a conversion of one unit that is going to become a community room or a laundry room or something else that benefits residents. There's been, a fire in one unit that is not connected to other units, and that unit is now beyond repair. So that's what we would call a de minimis exception. Not sizable number of units are lost to this. So I'm not going to talk about this in great detail, but it is something to keep in mind that there are some small exceptions to Section 18, even if it does mean the demolition or disposition of units. So when there is a demolition or disposition application, the department within HUD that oversees that application process is known as the Special Application Center, or SAC. SAC is headquartered in Chicago's HUD office, and they work with local HUD field offices to evaluate whether or not an application has complied with the rules under both Section 18 and other federal laws, most significantly civil rights laws. And it works with those local HUD field offices to either approve or deny that application. The way that this works is that there is an application that is compiled and filed with the Special Application Center. SAC then can approve the application, but if SAC does not approve of the application, that application doesn't move forward. That application is disapproved at SAC and does not move forward until an approved application can be submitted at a later date. If SAC does recommend the approval of a demolition or disposition application, that is then forwarded to the Assistant Secretary of Public Housing for the ultimate approval that comes. There are a number of reasons why SAC should not be approving a demolition application. First, the housing authority must certify that what they're doing is consistent with their plan. And it must certify a number of things that I'll go into more detail in just a minute. But if HUD sees that there is clear inconsistency between what the housing authority is submitting to HUD and with information that HUD has, they have to not approve the application. If there is an inconsistency with the housing authority's own plan, for example, if they have made no mention that that they are planning to pursue Section 18 for one of their developments, that would be clearly inconsistent with their plans to then move forward with that application. HUD can also look at its own data or request additional data from the housing authority and frequently does so. So one place where it would be clearly inconsistent is if there have been a series of passing REACT scores at the development without significant health and safety issues. And then HUD is moving to approve a Section 18 application, or the housing authority is pursuing a Section 18 application, that may very well be clearly inconsistent with the plan, or clearly inconsistent with the Section 18 approval process. Second, HUD should not approve any application that's not developed in consultation with the residents and with local government officials. So there must be a series of meetings with the resident advisory board, tenant council, individual residents to discuss, you know, this plan to pursue demolition or disposition, and there must be consultation with local government officials. Now, when we talk about the test for demolition in the process that SAC is going to be evaluating in approving or not approving a Section 18 demolition application, the first factor that HUD is going to look at is obsolescence. I'll go into more detail about what this means in a second, but in short, obsolete means that the physical condition is obsolete, the location or potentially other factors are obsolete and make it unsafe to continue to be public housing for the residents. In addition to the development being obsolete for a number of reasons, it must also be that there is no reasonable way to modify the development in a cost-effective way to return it to its useful life. So, you know, what this means is that there's no reasonable amount of investment, capital improvement that could be done to the development to make it not obsolete anymore. And one additional wrinkle is there can be an application that is not for the entirety of the development and is instead for a portion of that development. And when that is the case, HUD is going to look at whether demolition of one portion of the development is going to help ensure the long-term viability of the remaining units, because we don't want to see a complete loss of all units, and preservation should be the ultimate goal to save as many units as possible. Okay, so when we talk about obsolescence in the Section 18 test, first we are looking at physical condition. So this is the structure of the building. Is there a cost-effective manner that could fix the structural deficiencies, or are there other kind of overarching design or site problems that are not fixable? You know, was the development built in a way that was not meant to last longer than it currently has been, you know, public housing? Are there other site problems that are rapidly changing the physical condition of the development? You know, was there a large amount of settlement that is creating structural problems for the building? Is there a lot of erosion? Is it in a flood zone? And, you know, there's a problem with the, you know, constant flooding at the development. But all of these physical conditions, you have to look at whether it's cost effective to repair them. And what HUD has decided that means is that 62.5% of the total development cost for an elevator building, or 57.14% of the total development cost for all other types of buildings, is that, you know, that's what cost effective means. So it's less than those percentages at the time that the application is submitted to HUD. And so if you're working in a building with residents who want to challenge that the development is actually not physically obsolete, it's really important to work with an expert structural engineer or somebody that can actually look at how expensive it would be to repair the building and to return it to its useful life. The next factor that HUD is considering is the location of the development in this obsolescence test. So has there been a significant physical deterioration in the surrounding neighborhood? Has there been a change from residential to industrial or commercial development? Or was the public housing, you know, built in an industrial corridor? Always make sure when this is a justification that you're analyzing any and all civil rights angles. Are there other environmental conditions that jeopardize the suitability of the site for residential use? Are there environmental contaminants that could impact the health of the residents? And if so, is there a way to repair those conditions? We always have to see if that is a possibility. So other factors that HUD will consider are about problems that really seriously affect the marketability, usefulness, or management of the property. So always question whether a housing authority is actually doing everything that it can to market public housing units. And if the housing authority is citing their inability to find residents to fully occupy the housing, what are they doing in terms of their affirmative marketing plan? Are they actually attempting to get the units occupied, or are they just kind of checking some boxes? So a lot for advocates to look into in terms of questioning the physical obsolescence threshold that that SAC is analyzing. I said that one of the requirements for the approval of the demolition disposition application is consultation with residents. The statute and the regulations require that the housing authority provides evidence of consultation with a number of groups, including tenants who are impacted, their representatives on resident councils and resident advisory boards, and that there is evidence of consultation with local government officials. The approval of an application from the Housing Authority's Board of Commissioners must include a signed resolution that takes place after this consultation is complete. Additionally, there must be compliance with the National Environmental Policy Act, NEPA, which requires an evaluation of adverse environmental impact of the demolition or disposition. And as part of that NEPA review, there also needs to be an analysis about whether or not there's an impact on housing that has possible landmark preservation status. So I just mentioned that because it's possible that there's been a landmark designation, and that could be a hook for a preservation campaign. So other requirements in a demolition or disposition application are that it must be authorized by the Public Housing Authority's plan, and the plan must be identical, that's what the regulations say, identical to the description in the demolition or disposition application. Again, if this is a demolition application that is for the partial demolition of a development, so not for all of the development, but just for a portion of it, that the viability of the remaining development needs to be considered. If it will reduce density to permit better access by emergency fire or rescue services, or will improve the marketability of the development or other developments in the Housing Authority's inventory. Additionally, HUD notice from 2018, which is PIH notice 2018-04, outlined additional grounds for very small housing authorities to remove the last of their public housing portfolio. So if a housing authority owns and operates 50 or less housing units, and it's been determined that it's in the best interest of the residents to close out the public housing program following a different HUD notice, which is PIH 2016-23. So it's followed all of those requirements for closing out. The public housing authority, then HUD may determine that it is in the best interest to approve that Section 18 application. Now, I would say it's always worth looking at whether there's preservation options that do not include the loss of those units as affordable housing units for the long term. Often, very small housing authorities operate some of the, you know, only subsidized housing in a community, and this can have a really significant impact on residents who call it their home. And so there may be potential preservation strategies that are an option. So when there is both demolition and disposition application submitted, there's always a question about, you know, what's going to happen to the residents in terms of relocation, what rights are they entitled to, what options are out there. We should always be analyzing whether or not there's been compliance with fair housing and other federal laws. First, whenever tenants are being displaced by a federal action, a relocation plan has to be submitted to HUD. Normally, the Uniform Relocation Act governs the relocation activities and the rights that are afforded to tenants who are displaced. However, under Section 18, demolition and disposition relocations, the Uniform Relocation Act does not apply because Section 18 includes its own, what we like to call a mini URA, for residents who are impacted by Section 18. And this is important because while the two laws are somewhat similar, there are pretty significant differences between the two. So it's important that when you're looking at Section 18 demolition disposition to know what laws apply to it. I will say that if there are other federal funds that are going to be used for the physical demolition of the site, it's possible that the URA is going to be triggered. And if the URA is triggered, there may be additional resources and options available for tenants. So make sure that when you're reviewing the demolition plan that that you're looking at the ways in which they're going to finance the demolition of the site. So what the mini URA for Section 18 looks like is that there's got to be replacement housing provided to the tenant. That can most frequently look like tenant protection vouchers, which are a form of tenant-based assistance, basically the same thing as a housing choice voucher or Section 8 voucher. But it could also look like a different, similarly subsidized unit, like a project-based voucher unit, like another public housing unit in the housing authority's portfolio, or like a form of project-based rental assistance, where tenants are still paying comparable rent. The relocation plan must also include the payment of any actual and reasonable relocation expenses. And so that's important because there's a lot of expenses involved in moving. This can look like, you know, transportation to view available units, the cost of hiring professional movers to move your belongings, security deposits, move-in fees, background check fees. It all really adds up when residents are being displaced and need to find a new place to live. And so the relocation plan needs to outline what those actual and reasonable relocation expenses are going to be and how residents are to receive them. When submitting the relocation plan, the housing authority must certify that each resident is actually going to be offered comparable housing. And that's really essential to make sure that the housing authority is actually living up to that promise. Housing authorities also, very critically, you know, in order to actually provide comparable housing, this should include any necessary counseling that residents need in order to actually move. And so this means that housing authorities should be identifying other units for tenants to move to and providing support for residents when trying to view those units and trying to navigate any barriers that tenants may face. The housing authority always needs to be monitoring and, you know, working to affirmatively further fair housing and working towards deconcentration in its relocation efforts. So it's really critical that the implementation of the relocation plan and the relocation plan itself allow tenants to receive the full range of housing choices that they need and receive adequate counseling to actually move to a neighborhood and a unit in a neighborhood that is of their choice. Before tenants can be forcibly relocated, tenants are entitled to a 90-day notice of displacement. The only exception to this is if the unit is, is very unsafe for health or safety reasons. For example, there's been a fire and the unit cannot be repaired. Then there's a potential that the notice requirement is not necessary, although the tenant would be entitled to housing still. However, you know, in most circumstances, a 90-day notice for all tenants is going to be required. This notice should inform residents that the building's not going to be demolished or sold out under them, and it will begin once everybody is out. That's important because housing authorities will sometimes threaten residents and say, you know, if you're not out by a certain day, we're just going to demolish this place around you. And that's really unhelpful. It should be clear to residents that under no circumstances will happen. The notice should also notify residents of replacement housing options and include an offer of comparable housing that meets housing quality standards and that is in an area not generally less desirable than the location of the resident's current housing. When the housing authority is submitting its plans for Section 18 demolition disposition, they are certifying compliance with civil rights laws. And that's really important to make sure that you're monitoring, to make sure that the actions of the housing authority are actually in compliance with civil rights laws. Most obviously, this includes compliance with the Fair Housing Act, which means, you know, the duty to not discriminate and the duty to affirmatively further fair housing. It also means compliance with Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act to ensure that tenants with disabilities have equal access to housing and are allowed reasonable accommodations and financial support during the Section 18 demolition disposition process. So now I want to talk a little specifically about Section 18 disposition. Under Section 18 disposition, there may be a preservation strategy behind the reason why the development is going through disposition, or it could mean that there's a total loss of the public housing unit. So it's important to really analyze what the plan looks like in order to know what option you're working with. So the disposition test, this is different from the demolition test, is that the housing authority can certify that retention of the property, so continuing to own the property, is not in the best interest of the residents. And the reasons for that are that the conditions of the development adversely affect the health and safety or feasible operation of the development, or disposition allows for the acquisition, development, or rehabilitation of other properties that would more effectively provide low-income housing. So this, you know, requires the total replacement of the housing units. But those units do not necessarily need to be public housing units. So this could be a sale of a public housing development to finance the construction of a new development somewhere else. And those units may, for example, be project-based voucher units, not public housing units. And so that is allowable, although there is a requirement of the replacement of those units as affordable housing units. The disposition must also, of course, be consistent with the Housing Authority's goals and plan, and with the U.S. Housing Act. When a disposition application is submitted, the Housing Authority must certify that the proceeds that it receives are going to pay for outstanding obligations used to finance that development or to make improvements to that development. It must certify that any proceeds left over will be used for the provision of low-income housing or otherwise for the benefit of residents, or to secure on-site commercial enterprises that benefit the residents. The Housing Authority must also certify that the Housing Authority has complied with the resident opportunity to purchase requirements. So that is the sale offered to eligible resident organizations, or residents can decide to partner with a nonprofit entity acting on their behalf. And the timeline for that must be certified to and followed, which includes the timeline for interest, offer, and acceptance. Proof of that process must be part of the application. So if this is happening in your community, take a look at these regulations, 24 CFR section 970.19, to analyze whether or not the Housing Authority has complied with the resident opportunity to purchase requirement. Now, when disposition is used as a preservation tool, there's a number of reasons that we have to remember for why that happens. Generally speaking, public housing does not allow for the physical improvements to be paid for through anything other than the public housing capital fund, or, you know, potentially some other sources of federal dollars. And that's important because the federal government has not allocated sufficient funds towards the capital fund for more than a decade. And as we all know, when you don't repair something in your home, when your landlord doesn't repair something in your home, it gets more costly to fix it down the line. And so because we have not paid for physical improvements, capital improvements to public housing developments across the country for a significant period of time, the amount of money in that capital fund is nowhere near what is necessary to finance the improvement of public housing. So one way that Congress has come up with to finance these the physical improvements that are necessary for housing to be habitable and of good quality for the tenants is by allowing private capital to finance construction, you know, so using low-income housing tax credits, using, you know, traditional mortgages or HUD-insured mortgages that allow for the finance, the long-term financing of a rehab. And so that can happen. The most common way that happens is through the rental assistance demonstration, or RAD. Housing authorities have the option to blend Section 18 with RAD, which means that some units will be RAD units and other units will be Section 18 units. What's important about that is while there are very long-term tenant protections available in the RAD program, that is not always the case in Section 18. But when you blend Section 18 with RAD, there are heightened requirements that apply to all units under the most recent RAD notice, and that's PIH 2018-04. And so there are significant tenant protections under RAD. There's going to be a separate webinar that is available on RAD and the tenant protections that go with it. But I really just want to emphasize that when there is a blend between Section 18 and RAD, you have to look at the RAD notice for how that plays out and what the tenant protections are that are available. Section 18, generally speaking, you know, could be used as a preservation tool, but is often blended with RAD. To summarize the opportunities for advocates to work with tenant councils, resident organizations, and tenants to preserve public housing in your community, there are a number of really critical lessons learned that the Shriver Center has learned over decades of doing this work. First, most critically, it is important that you are monitoring what is going into the housing authority's plans. Are there potential Section 18 demolition or disposition activities that could come down the line? If there are things in their plan related to Section 18, you should monitor to make sure that that residents are aware of that that possibility, and that residents are informed of their rights and their options. It's important to get in as early as possible. That means before relocation begins, and preferably before the application is submitted and approved to HUD, so that you and the residents, that the residents can really be heard throughout this process. Also important that when you see a Section 18 demolition disposition as part of the housing authority's plan, that you're not then seeing a decline in the number of units that are occupied. The housing authority is under an obligation to continue to maintain and rent out its units. And if there is a decline in the number of occupied units, that is cause for concern, and you should get involved to make sure that those units can remain occupied. If the housing authority is saying, for example, that the physical conditions are obsolete, but it doesn't, you know, appear to you to be something that is not fixable, or, you know, the housing has passing REAC inspections, or you know, something else where there's a, where it seems possible that there, that the physical conditions are fixable. My recommendation is to hire an expert, like a structural engineer, to actually do an inspection of the development and to question the housing authority's cost predictions for fixing the development. At every step in the process as well, it's important to analyze any and all civil rights angles, whether that is at the front end for the justification for the demolition. For example, if the city is saying that they want to get rid of the public housing because they want to gentrify the part of town that the housing authority is in, that's you know, red alert for housing discrimination and race discrimination, most likely. And so it's really critical to analyze the civil rights implication at the front end, but it's also important to analyze it at the back end, even if there is a justification under the law for the approval of a demolition application. It's important to make sure that that relocation plan is actually allowing residents to have real housing choice, that it is protecting the rights of people with disabilities to reasonable accommodations and other supports to ensure that that folks aren't ending up institutionalized as a result of the demolition. And it's important to make sure that the environmental review compliance is happening. For example, you can look at whether or not the building is a historic landmark or has that potential, and whether it needs to be preserved or there are additional resources available to preserve it as a result of that status. I am available to answer any and all questions. Again, my name is Emily Coffey, a housing justice staff attorney at the Shriver Center on Poverty Law. I look forward to answering any and all questions that you have about the potential Section 18 demolition disposition applications in your community. I'm reachable at 312-724-8411 or at my email address, emilycoffey@povertylaw.org. Thank you for joining. Take care.